Coming up next is Thomas, who again needs no further introduction. His contributions to wireless industries and LoRa community is really greatly appreciated. And please give a big round of applause for Thomas Tuckham.
Okay. The biggest challenge is to get this working. So if this works, then we're fine. Ah, there we go. That works. So we actually have a few minutes, so I will start with a few slides. So first of all, I changed the topic of today's talk. It was something about satellites and low orbit, but actually the real topic of the talk is less talking, more doing. Because when I was making these slides, I thought that's actually what I'm talking about, that it's about satellites, it's just a side effect. And it's also one of the slogans for this conference. So 60 years ago, the Russians launched Sputnik 1 in 1957. It was circling around the world, and it was sending out these beeps, I believe, at 20 and 40 megahertz. And everybody could hear them, and everybody was listening. So here you actually see Americans trying to capture the Sputnik 1. And basically, 60 years later, we're doing exactly the same thing. So we have a satellite, it is sending something out, but now they're not beeps, they're actually chirps. That's the only difference. So for a few days, we have something that we call TTN Set 1, which we can play with and which is sending LoRa messages to us. I'll tell more where the satellite comes from. But also the reason for this title, Less Talking, More Doing, is that it's really a project that involved a lot of people, ESA, Space Norway, the Norwegian Space Center, the Things Network, to get together to actually make this work. Let's switch to, before I continue with the slides, to the live view. Let's see if that's... now I lost it on my screen. Hang on, this is difficult because now I have to find my cursor back. If anybody sees it, then tell me. It's not on... There it is. There it is. Yeah, there we go. I knew this was difficult. Now need to go back to my screen to pick something up. Ah, there we go. Okay, at least that's something. Yeah. So here we have the live tracking that actually is also in the hallway. So the satellite circling the Earth at an orbit of 600 kilometers at a speed of 7.5 kilometers per second. So right now it's over Africa. But at that speed, it will be here really in a few minutes. On the right top there, you can say the next visibility of TTN set is in 2 minutes and 30 seconds. So again, it's really moving fast. The yellow circle you see is the area of the world where this satellite is above the horizon at this moment. So within the yellow circle, you can actually see the satellite. A few more, this is difficult. a few more statistics here at the bottom. So I said it's moving at roughly 7.5 kilometers per second, which also means that you get something which is called the Doppler effect. The same thing if you have a police car that's moving towards you, you hear the siren at a slightly higher frequency, and then it passes you, the frequency goes down. The same happens to the radio. So here you see the Doppler. This is at 100 megahertz, that it's 2,000 hertz, which also means your radio transmission is 2,000 hertz of the center frequency. I'm telling this because later we're actually measuring this. We can actually see if we can see this on the receiver. So we have to wait a few seconds until it comes into view. The satellite is programmed to send seven LoRa messages all the time. So it cycles through the same seven messages every 20 seconds or so and transmits them down. You can receive them with a simple normal LoRa chip. So the LoRa chip that sits in any of your devices is used here to receive this satellite. I have many more pictures on how this looks like later. So there's nothing fancy. There's not a special satellite receiver or anything. No special antennas, just the right antenna for this frequency. So we have to wait a few seconds until the satellite comes in view. There, it should be in 38 seconds. That's the moment in which you can also see the elevation over here. Where's my pointer? The elevation over here, it's now minus 1 degree, so it's under the horizon. At the moment, it's at zero, it's at the horizon. Now, the problem is the antenna is on the roof here of the Rockstad building. But if you look around in this area, you don't see the horizon. You see a lot of other buildings. So it depends a little bit on where it appears. But anywhere between 0 and 5 degrees, we should start receiving the messages. At the moment we receive the messages, you will see them over here. I'll scroll out the few messages that were from the last pass. So right now, the satellite is over the horizon. And now, this is always the most scary and exciting moment. Will it work? We had many of these passes where it didn't work, and all the people involved, I'll show you the list. We were all sitting there at 11 o'clock at night, like, did it work? No, it didn't work. And until it actually worked. And now it's working perfectly. So in the hallway, when you have time later on, when the satellite passes, it's printed live on a telex, which is also fun to view. So hopefully within a few seconds, so we're at 2 degrees elevation now, at 190 degrees, so I a little bit lost my orientation where north and south is here. But hopefully within a few seconds, we'll see something appearing here. Unfortunately for this morning, there it is, yay! There it is, okay, it works. So over here you see the messages. DTN start calling here. Thanks to ESA, Space Norway, Norwegian Space Center, and Semtech. Let's build this thing together. The secret code. Ah, now I spoiled it. That was the challenge. The first person to find the code or to actually receive messages would win a small prize. Goodbye. And then it waits a little bit and it starts again. Sometimes you have a COC error. And here's a lot of metadata that we also receive and we can map later. Okay, let's get back to the story. Oh, now I need my cursor. Does this work? Yeah, perfect. Okay, here we go. So we are at Rockstart. On top of the building is an antenna. The frequency this thing is transmitting at is 162 megahertz. That's a maritime frequency used for AIS, for ship tracking. So I bought an antenna from sailshop.nl. It's a very good antenna. Together with a small receiver, you see it over here. It's nothing more than the development board from Semtech for 169 megahertz. That's connected to a Raspberry in a metal case, mainly for the rain over here. And in the main hall, you see the telex printing it out. At the same time, we have people in Delft on top of the EWI building. That's the high building in Delft you see at the university. They have a nice antenna farm for satellite tracking. One of the antennas is hooked up to the same type receiver as this one over here, but it's also hooked up to an SDR, so we can actually see what's happening at the same time. So I have some examples of what we have captured there. So less talking, more doing. When I was working on these slides, I realized that it's actually quite special we managed to do this. And that's really because of all these people didn't talk a lot, but just did it. First, Frank Zeppenfeld, who actually is here today, he's the one who actually made it happen and came up with the idea, like, can we use this NORSAT to broadcast these LoRa messages? We were looking for something to do during the conference that had something to do with satellite, and it was his idea actually to start broadcasting these messages using this satellite. Nader, also from ESA, did a lot of work on the processing of the IQ and for the upload. Then the people from Space Norway, who actually were very excited about this and said, okay, let's just do this and see if it works. And if it doesn't work, too bad. If it works, we have a very nice demo. Lars and Frank, who actually work also at night to make the things work on the satellite. Nicolas Sonner from Semtech, who was here 2 days ago speaking. He provided the samples, I will explain later, that were uploaded to the satellite. Then the people in Delft, who actually last minute set up the whole satellite farm, hooked everything up and made it work. Also Dario and Marek Buma, who provided the telex and made that one work. And myself, talking to you today. I'm actually the only one who's talking and not doing. So this is NORSAT. It's launched in July last year. It's a fairly new satellite. Its main purpose is for maritime monitoring and broadcasting. So it's for following ships that send out AIS signals to follow where they are in the Nordic regions where there are no ground stations for emergency, for general tracking, and also for data transfer. There's one payload in there for experimenting with a new system called VDES, which is VHF data exchange, to actually have higher data rate exchange of data with ships, like messages to the harbor they're coming, or whatever transmissions they want to do, and to also offload the AIS frequencies. For us, the nice thing is it has an SDR transceiver. A lot of people already asked, do you have a LoRa chip in there? No, the satellite has no clue what LoRa is. I think even some of the people involved in the project have no clue what LoRa is. They just pass the file, put it on the satellite, and it broadcasts the signal. It's fairly powerful. It can send at 2.5 watts. We're not doing that. We actually powered it down to, I think, around 26 dBm, but it's a little bit unclear how much loss there is and what the exact number is. But the real nice feature of this satellite is the antenna. It's a huge antenna for a satellite, because at 162 megahertz, you need an antenna of like 80 centimeters. That's way larger than the satellite is. So they did something very fancy to deploy it, and I have a movie to show that. It was developed in 26 months, including the delay for the launch, which in the satellite industry, for this complicated satellite, is very, very fast. Also note that this is not a CubeSat, this is slightly larger. Earlier this week, I was talking about another project where we actually have a CubeSat that's going to listen to LoRa devices. So just to make clear, this is something completely different. This is another satellite that's already existing, has nothing to do with LoRa, and it's just we're actually using it only for 3 days. This evening is the last transmission, and then we give it back, and they can do useful stuff with it again. It's the world's first VDES satellite. So I already talked a little bit about the orbits. I think the most important thing here to realize is that a geostationary satellite, the ones you point your dish at for your television, they are really far away. That's 36,000 kilometers. That's really far. This one is really close. The one we're using today is 600 kilometers. It's something you can drive in a day. I mean, it's not very far. It's just up. That's the difference. Also, they go really fast around the world. Every 100 minutes, it makes an orbit around the world. But obviously, it's much simpler, much cheaper. You have less radiation. It's a complete different game than these high satellites. I'm not going into the specific orbits that was last time. Basically, you see it passing over the world all the time. It goes from pole to pole, and then, because the Earth is turning at the same time, you cover the whole world nicely in a day. Okay, let's get to it. This is the antenna, and you see how huge it is compared to the satellite. Obviously, you cannot launch it with the antenna deployed. That just doesn't fit. So they had to come up with something to actually fold the antenna in. Apparently, this was a very scary process if it really would work, the deployment. So they had a small camera in the satellite. So after they deployed it, they could actually turn on the camera and check if the antenna really was deployed and how it looked like. Now comes the most exciting slide. Watch carefully. This is in the lab where they actually try to deploy the antenna to see how that will work. It's a small movie. There it goes. In slow motion. Just for the wow effect, we do it once more. With sound. The good news is it actually worked, because it's in space now, and we're using it today. Okay, I don't really understand most of the errors on this slide. I just copied it from a document. It's just to explain that why we're using this 162 megahertz, because it has nothing to do with all the other LoRa things we do. Simply, this satellite can only transmit at this frequency, because this VDES protocol that I was talking about will be here, in the very close to the AIS. So this is where the ships send their tracking information. You will see later in the SDR traces very high power signals there. The satellite can downlink, so sent from the satellite to ships, specifically in those channels, and those are the channels we are using for the experiment today. So in frequencies, you have five of these VDES channels. Because LoRa is a little wasteful on the bandwidth side, we use all five of them as one big channel. So here we actually put our LoRa signals. Actually, on Twitter, we already got a few complaints about doing 125 kilohertz in the VHF band, which I think is actually a fair comment. This is really a nice trial. Get some experience, get some data. But this is there's no proposal to do this at these frequencies for real. This is a one-time thing. As I explained, so the satellite has an SDR on board, and because this VDES protocol is experimental, they still want to try different waveforms and do experiments. So they put a very generic SDR in there, because when they launched the satellite, they didn't know what kind of modulation they would use. And that's actually the reason we can put this LoRa signal in there. So Nicola, on his laptop in MATLAB, creates the baseband signal for the transmission in an IQ file at 300 kilosamples per second. They send it to the satellite, and actually, if you replay it, you see a spectrum like this, where here is your wideband LoRa signal. The file is uploaded to the satellite, and the satellite knows when it's passing over Amsterdam, and whenever Amsterdam is in view, they will start transmitting the file. It's really like having an MP3 file with audio that's being replayed. In this case, it's an IQ file with radio that's being replayed, but the idea is exactly the same. Okay, this is the receiver. I think I already showed it with the sailing ship antenna. And here are my new friends from Delft who are putting the antenna on the roof. Actually, it came down because of the storm two weeks ago. Here we obviously have much better reception than within the city of Amsterdam, but it's really interesting to see the results here. So here we're using this antenna, which has a very nice pattern for catching the satellites. There's an amplifier over here, such that we can get the signal back to the room where all the equipment is. And here we have that simple Semtech SX1272 chip in parallel to the SDR. So we can see what the LoRa chip says about the signal, and we can compare that what we see in the SDR. This was one of the nights where we were hoping to see a signal and where nothing came down. But actually, the reason to show it is then you see what's in the band. So over here on the right, this very strong signal is one of the AAS channels. So this is all ships sending location information. Over here, all kind of maritime transmissions. I have no clue what it is. I see some audio sometimes. This is the part where basically our LoRa signal was supposed to be. But you also see that other people are sending here. It can be ships. It can be weather broadcasts from Coast Guard. I have very little knowledge about what's happening in this band. But what we see is that even through our LoRa signal, there are very strong interferers, like these over here. And here, this is the final moment that the signal went on. This was very exciting. Here you see still somebody interfering. They were fixing things on the satellite, and then suddenly, pop, you see the LoRa signals, very wideband, you see compared to this one, very wideband signals, not extremely strong, also because of the distance and the reduced power. But here you see real LoRa signals coming from space. And you see somebody actually interfering with it, with our nice LoRa. And it might be a real user that actually writes in that band, but that's another story. So when it finally worked, now we can start tracking it. Here you actually see a full pass, where you see that the signal is getting stronger when the satellite is closer to you, when it's coming over your head, or at least at a high elevation. You also see the Doppler. You see that the signal starts at a higher frequency, and then during the pass, which is going upward, you see that it's slightly to a lower frequency. It's not a whole lot, it's about 2 kilohertz, but still you clearly see it in this picture. I think this one was at night, because there's much less other interference happening there. They made a movie, so here you see really what's happening. So you see the pause between the LoRa transmissions, and then it starts sending again. We're very lucky that this thing over here was not in our band, because otherwise the whole experiment would have not worked. I don't know what it is, but it's really strong. And Delft is not even close to the sea or anything, but they're very high on the building. But basically, this gives a nice picture of the signals live coming in. at least at that time. Then back to the Rockstar building. So here we don't have that good equipment, and we're in a very hostile environment with a lot of reflections, a lot of blocking, and we're very close to the harbor here. You really see much more interference here. This is what I measure with the thing on the roof. The only thing I can measure is basically the signal level I see when there's no LoRa. So the satellite is not sending here. If there's no interference, at least not from somebody using the band, I see something like minus 105 or minus 103 dBm noise floor. That's extremely bad. Without interference or without noise, the thermal noise floor would be around minus 123. That's somewhere over there, over the screen. This was really surprising to me. A lot of the radio amateurs might be much more used to this, but the noise in this band is dramatic. As soon as you put the antenna on, you have 15-20 dB of extra noise. It's very hard to get rid of. Even at my house, it was really bad. We have been tracing back to it. These computers are a big source of noise, as well as Ethernet cables, because they have a 100 megahertz signal, which is not very clean, and they generate all this wideband noise. So it's really, really, really bad. And then there's somebody sending as well. That makes it even worse. Here clearly somebody, some maritime user is sending, which is fine. Actually, it's interesting to see how well the LoRa behaves in the presence of interference. So this is really fresh. This is the pass before the one I just showed you. This was at 10 or 11. Yeah, 10:24 this morning. This is the elevation, so that's the angle above the horizon. So it starts at zero when it comes at the horizon. We pick it up at 5 degrees, which is still very low, considering all the buildings here. And then it rises to 35, which is about this far above the horizon. And then it descends again, and it goes down here, even under 5 degrees. You see clearly all these different paths where we receive the messages. There are some gaps, probably also buildings in between, or interference. As I said, people are really using this band at the same time. This one is very interesting. This is the Doppler shift, which, when it just comes over the horizon, is almost 4 kilohertz, actually. And we have measured it, and we have predicted it. The blue ones are what we have measured, and the green ones is what we really have what we have predicted. Actually, I think it looks really, really good, especially here in the middle. The error is really small. Here it's a little bit more, but still on the full scale, it's not very much. And I don't know why the difference is there. Either it's an issue with the measurement, or it's the issue with the calculation, which is also possible. I wrote the code myself, so that could be a mistake in there. But still. Just for a trial. This is actually the first time I could look at the data, so this is really fresh. This one is a bit more surprising. This is the signal-to-noise ratio. So basically how far the LoRa signal is below the noise that we see for the entire pass again. I'm a little surprised that I don't see any line in there. It's very flat. It's actually one of the things that they had predicted, because what I didn't tell yet is that the satellite has this Yagi antenna, which is basically a directional antenna, which is pointed at the horizon. So when the satellite passes, it follows Amsterdam, but only in the horizontal plane. So it always keeps pointing at Amsterdam, but the elevation is always on the horizon. So the most signal goes to the horizon. So if it gets closer, you get less signal from the antenna. But then again, the satellite is closer. So the idea is that difference should be zero. Maybe that's the reason we see it this flat, that actually the signal strength is quite flat over the whole pass. There's a lot of processing we have to do. As I said, I had to do this in 5 minutes with the live data, so we need to look more at this. And another trial we did earlier is at my house, where I have multiple passes with different elevations. So you basically, the satellite starts here, it goes up to a certain elevation and then goes down again. And here I do see a lot of difference in the signal to noise ratios. Again, so this is the reason we're doing this kind of experiment, is to learn about how well these things work and what the different effects are. It's also possible that the reason we see this variation over here is because there's a lot of interference here. I live in the middle of the country, so there's much less maritime-related traffic. Okay, then the last part. Can you do this yourself? There was a challenge on the forum, who would receive the signal. It's really doable. You need to have the right equipment, but that's what I thought. This is a small HopperRef module from like 11 euros connected to an Arduino Micro, and I can perfectly receive the signal with this thing. Look at the antenna. It's nowhere near a tuned 80-centimeter sailing boat antenna, and still it worked. I actually have it over here. It's just this thing, and it could actually receive the signal from the satellite very well. Even more exciting. So Nicola, who was here earlier this week and who was very excited about this whole project, he was on the train back home yesterday. So he was in the TGV at 270 kilometers per hour, and he still had this receiver running. So he put it on the window. He was somewhere between Brussels and Grenoble. I don't know exactly where. He was tracking the satellite, turns on the receiver, and he receives it. So this was really amazing. So you have the Doppler of the satellite plus the Doppler of the train. And he had a really good reception, and he was very excited about that. So that brings us to our prize. So as far as I know, there's only one person who actually managed to receive the signal himself. And there was some discussion on the forum, like, what kind of equipment do you need? And I mailed, well, a 433 megahertz module, that's not going to work because that has too much attenuation. And that triggered Stuart. He said, well, if somebody says it doesn't work, then we try it. And Stuart tried it from his hotel room behind the window, and he did receive some message. He didn't receive the code, but I think that's been it. He clearly had received the messages. Ivo van Ling of RFI Engineering has been trying it as well. Last time I checked, and a half an hour ago, he didn't have the signal yet. So we have a clear winner, which is Stuart. And we have a prize. We actually have multiple prizes, which I'm allowed to give to Stuart for this great achievement. Congratulations. So from the Things Network, we have a Things Note.
Oh, wonderful.
And from ESA, with congratulations as well, we have a hat, which you have to wear. And we have a shirt, and if it's the wrong size, we might try to exchange it for a larger one. But
if they want to see the receiver, 4 o'clock this afternoon.
Exactly. So that's my last point. So this was the story about a TTN set. I think it was a really amazing experiment. And again, it's about all the people involved actually doing something and not making a project plan, etc. Just, okay, let's try this, see if it works. And it worked. And I think we did something really special here. Stuart has a talk at 4 o'clock about $1.50 set and other things he did with Laura. And he will show the receiver that he used to win his hat. up till midnight tonight, the thing is transmitting. So there's one more pass at 11 o'clock or so our time. And after that, we only have the slides and the recording. And then that's it. Thank you.
Yeah, Thomas, this is some fantastic stuff. I mean, you make these complicated things so easy. It's like a kid's play, you know. My question to you would be, you've been involved with LoRaWAN from space for the last few months. You've been doing different experiments. What's been the inspiration for doing this sort of a thing?
For doing LoRaWAN from space?
Yeah.
Yeah, actually, I was talking to Jan Willem from SODAC, who I see there over there. And he actually mentioned something which is really true. I think it's already 2 years back, he arranged an experiment with launching a balloon, which was actually the first time I realized you could do that and you could. And that has triggered a lot of things. So maybe that's where it started.
Well, I hope this triggers a lot of more activities in our community as well.
Yeah.
Does anyone want to ask questions to Thomas?
Hi, so the Semtech chip is not expecting Doppler. Did you have to do any kind of pre-processing for that, or was it subtle enough?
No, interesting. It's not expecting Doppler. What it is expecting is really bad crystals. So they made the demodulation such that it can actually deal with really, really, really bad crystals. But nobody uses really bad crystals these days anymore because they're much cheaper. So all the room there is for dealing with a bad crystal is used to deal with the Doppler now. So there's no process, there's no configuration. It just works out of the box. That's the beauty. Yeah.
Thanks a lot, Thomas. And if anyone needs to find Thomas, he'll be there near the Telex machine. Feel free to go there and ask him anything you want about his project. Thanks a lot, Thomas.
Thank you.